What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Following our introductory trees video, and as promised, today we are going to delve in binary search trees. Therefore, if you haven't watched the previous video of the series or are not familiar with the basic terminology of trees, then make sure you do. Binary search trees are essentially a subtype or implementation of binary trees. So, the nodes of a binary search tree can have at most two children, a left node and a right node. However, what differentiates a binary tree from a general binary tree is that every left node or left subtree must be smaller than its parent, and every right node or right subtree must be bigger than its parent. So, the tree colored in red you can see to your left-hand side is a binary tree. But it isn't a binary search tree, because a few left nodes are bigger than their parents. Whereas, the tree you see to your right-hand side is indeed a binary search tree, as every left node is smaller than its parent, and every right node or subtree is bigger than its parent. Now, why did these trees come to be? Couldn't we just do whatever we needed to do using a normal binary tree? Why add this extra layer of complexity and this smaller, bigger rule? Well, the answer lies in its name, as what it does best is searching for an item inside it, inside the tree. You see, if we want to search for an item by value inside a list, we have to go through these items one by one until we hit a match. And in terms of complexity, searching inside a list is O of n time complexity. However, with this one extra added condition, if we want to retrieve an item from a tree, what we do is start from the root node, and if the item we want to find is bigger than the root, we just go right. With this first iteration, only one, we just eliminated half the item candidates inside the tree. And if we keep dividing these elements by 2 until we reach this one item we are looking for, we will obtain something like that. N, which is the number of elements or nodes we have, will be divided by 2 until we reach the item we want. Or in the worst case, if this item was at the bottom of the tree, like this example, these divisions can be represented by 2 to the power the height of the tree. Let's relate this equation to the example in front of us. If we want to find the node with value 12, what we do is start at the root node, which is 10, then go right, and then left. That is 2 divisions by 2, and the level of 12 is 2, which also happens to be the height of our tree. Therefore, the number of divisions needed in a worst-case scenario is equal to the height of the tree. Now, by wrapping both sides with log base 2, we can easily see that O of h is equal to O of log base 2 of n, which is way faster than searching inside a list. Now, this O of log base 2 of n might not always be met, because in some cases, we may not have a balanced or symmetric tree, similar to the one in our example. You see, this tree is perfectly symmetric or balanced, and with every level, we take out half the nodes of our tree. But take a look at this tree. It is completely asymmetric, and in order to reach the end node or node 12 like we previously did, we will have to traverse all the nodes of our tree, leaving us again with an O of n time complexity. However, these problems were tackled with self-balancing trees, such as AVL trees and red-black trees, which we will make sure to cover in future videos. During the previous example, we covered one of the operations offered by binary search trees, and it is retrieving an item by value. Now, what if I want the minimum or maximum value stored inside the tree specifically? Where should I look? Well, because every left node is smaller than its parent, and every right node is bigger than its parent, then the minimum element is stored to the far left side of the tree, and the maximum is stored to the far right side of the tree. Now, these nodes do not magically appear inside a tree, we have to insert them. And inserting an element is the next operation on our list. The insert operation, given a certain value, starts at the root node and checks if the node we want to insert is smaller than the root, we go left. If not, we go right. We keep repeating this process on the node we hopped on until we find an empty slot to insert our node in. Let's try to insert a node having a value of 14 inside the tree you can see. It is bigger than the root, so we have to go right. It is smaller than the following node, so we go left, and then right. Now, because there are no more nodes to compare it to, we insert it here, and that's it. Next is the delete operation, and instead of one, we actually have two types of delete, the soft delete and hard delete. The soft delete marks the node as removed, but does not actually remove it from the tree. The hard delete goes ahead and literally removes the node from the tree. However, while doing this, we may encounter three cases or three types of nodes. The first one is if the node we want to delete is a leaf node. In order to delete such a node, all we have to do is make its parent point to nothing or null. The second case is if the node we want removed has a single child. Then we have to update the parent of this node to point to its grandchild directly or to the child of the node we want to delete. In this example, we removed node 6, and in order not to lose the information stored in its child, we made the parent of 6, which is 10, point to the child of 6, which is 9. The last case in the hard delete operation is if the node we want to delete has two children. Then we have two ways to deal with this, and both are totally fine. Either we find the largest item in its left subtree, or its predecessor, or we can find the smallest item in its right subtree, or its successor. In this example, we are going to take the predecessor. The next thing we have to do is set the value of the item to delete to be equal to the predecessor we just found. We now have two nodes inside the tree holding the same value. Doing this will put us in a position similar to one of the two we just covered, when we try to delete the initial predecessor's node. In this case, deleting the predecessor returns to simply deleting a leaf node. Now, before starting with the implementation, the last thing I want to discuss is traversal. We can traverse a tree in three ways, in an in-order, pre-order, or post-order manner. To traverse a tree in an in-order manner, we have to visit the left subtree, then the root, then the right subtree recursively for every node. Additionally, this type of traversal will lead to the sorting of the values of the tree. So, if we have integers stored inside the tree, the in-order traversal will lead to the numerical sorting. And if we have strings stored inside the tree, this traversal will lead to the alphabetical sorting. Let's try to traverse this tree in an in-order manner together. We have to start by the left subtree of the root first, then the root, then its right subtree. Same applies to every subtree we listed. So, the left subtree of the root is also traversed in the same manner, leading to the numerical sorting you can see in front of you. On the other hand, to do a pre-order traversal, we have to visit the root node first, followed by the left subtree, and finally the right subtree recursively. And finally, concerning the post-order traversal, you may already have guessed this one, as it involves visiting the left subtree first, followed by the right subtree, and then the root node recursively for every node in the tree. Now, let's go ahead and try to implement all the binary search tree operations we covered together. The first thing we have to do is create the node which will wrap our data and will point to its left and right children. As usual, we try to make this class as generic as possible to be able to store any kind of data inside this tree. However, this data must extend the comparable interface, as knowing which node is smaller or bigger than the other is mandatory in building and maintaining a binary search tree. The annotations you can see are Lombok annotations. They basically remove all the boilerplate code related to getters, setters, constructors, toString methods, and equals and hash code methods. If you have no idea what these annotations are, do not worry. We have a video here on Geekific detailing all you need to know about Lombok. Make sure to check it. Now, before diving in the actual implementation, let's create a tree interface for the binary search tree where we will define all the operations a tree can offer. These are the operations we covered in this video. So, after implementing this tree interface, we should be able to insert an item to the tree, delete an item from the tree, traverse the tree, retrieve the maximum or minimum value stored inside the tree, and we will be able to check whether the tree is empty or not. Let's start our implementation with the binary search tree class itself. This class contains only a single node, the root node. This node, similarly to the root of a linked list, is enough to access the whole tree. If the root is equal to null or is non-present, then the tree must be empty. And that is the condition we used to implement the isEmpty operation listed in the tree interface. Okay, to retrieve the minimum item from the list, what I suggest to start with is checking if the tree is empty or not. Because if it is, it might throw a null pointer exception. So, if the tree is empty, we will return null. Now, remember that the minimum value is stored to the far left side of the tree, as we previously saw. So, what we have to do is start from the node and keep iterating over the left children of this tree until we hit a null value, or in other terms, the end of the tree. When this happens, we will be sure that we stumbled upon the minimum element of the tree, and then we can return the data stored inside it. For the folks out there who love recursion, yes, there is a way to implement this in a recursive manner. All you have to do is take the while loop, replace it with an if statement, and wrap all this logic inside a new method, which takes a node as an argument. This method should then be called from the initial getMin method, and should be provided with the root as an initial value. Retrieving the maximum is very similar to what we just wrote, but except of going to the far left of the tree, we have to go to the far right of the tree, as we mentioned at the beginning of the video. Literally everything else remains the same. Also, regarding the recursive call, the getMax method can be made recursive using the same chain of thought used for retrieving the minimum value of the tree. Now, in the interface, we have only one traverse function. However, we covered these traversal methods. That is because they are very similar to one another and all are implemented recursively. So, we are going to try to implement the in-order traversal method, and you will see that the two others can be easily guessed from this one implementation. So, the initial traverse method is going to call the in-order traversal helper method, which takes a node as parameter, as it is a recursive call. This method is provided with the root node initially, and will start by checking if the node passed to it is null, and if it isn't, it should proceed with the traversal. To better understand what is happening, let's take this simple tree as an example, and consider the node passed to the in-order traversal method to be the root node. Now, remember, we previously mentioned that in an in-order traversal, we have to traverse the left subtree, then the root, then the right subtree. Therefore, to print out the tree you can see in front of you, we have to print its left node first, then the root node provided to the method, then the right node. However, problems arise with this implementation when the left and the right nodes are not leaf nodes, but instead are subtrees themselves. In this case, what we should do is use the same logic we just used, hence the traverse in order method, on each of the left and right nodes individually. So, traversing the left and right subtree is done by calling recursively the same method on the left and right nodes of the node passed to the method. Now, when you run this method, you will have the sorting you hoped for. Concerning the pre-order and post-order, all you have to do is play around with these three lines of code based on the traversal definitions we discussed earlier in this video. Okay, now let's move on to the not-so-easy part, inserting to and deleting an item from the tree, which will both be implemented in a recursive manner. Recursion, in such cases, always means having a couple methods, and for the insert case, it is no different. We will have a helper method that takes a node just like the others, but on top of this, it will take a data item, you know, the data we will be adding to the tree. Now, before implementing this method further, let's take a look at the initial insert method that will be called by the user through the interface. As usual, in this method, we will first proceed by checking if the tree is empty. Because if it is, then the node we are trying to insert will be none other than the new root node of our tree. However, if the tree is not empty, then this recursive method we just created has to be called, and it will be provided initially with the data we want to add and the root node, which is our starting node. In this method, returning the whole tree object allows me to chain insertion calls. This is not mandatory and a pure choice. I personally prefer to do it this way, but you can simply return a boolean or void if you like. Now let's proceed to the implementation of the recursive method. This method will insert an item into a binary search tree, and because of that, while looping over the tree using this recursive method in search of an empty slot, we have to check if the node we want to insert is smaller or bigger than the node we are currently standing at, to see if we need to go left or go right. So, if it is smaller, we have to deal with the left subtree, and if it is bigger, we have to deal with the right subtree. Now, for each subtree or node, we have to see if this node is null or non-existent, because if that is the case, then that is where our new node should be inserted. So, if the node, whether the right or the left one, is null, we have to create a new node using the data provided to us by the user. Then set this node to be the left or right child respectively of the node we are currently standing at. However, if it isn't, then the recursive insert method should be called on the subtree we are in. This call will allow us to go through the same process, which means to search for an empty slot while traversing the lower levels of the tree. Now, if this recursion isn't enough for you, let me tell you that there is indeed another way to implement the insertion inside a tree. The second technique we are going to discuss is referred to as a heavily recursive way. So, in our initial insert method, instead of checking if the tree is empty or not, we will simply call the recursive helper method, as inside this recursive method, we will first proceed by checking if the node passed to it is null. Then it will return a new node. Now, because we are assigning the results of this method to the root, inserting our first item will go just fine. The next part of this recursive method is very similar to the first one. It is checking if the data we want to insert is smaller or bigger than the node we are currently standing at, to know if we will deal with the left subtree of this node or its right subtree. Now, here comes the tricky part. Inside these if statements, I am going to directly set the value of the left child or right child respectively to the output of the insert method, as you can see. So, what is happening here? To understand things better, let's try to add a second and a third node to the tree you can see in front of you. This tree contains currently a single node, the root node, equal to 1. If we try to insert 3 to this tree, the recursive method will be passed the value 3 and the node 1. The node is obviously not null, hence the first if statement is skipped. And 3 is bigger than 1, so we find ourselves in the else if block. Now, what the code will do is set the right child of 1 to be the result of the insert method. This method will have as parameters the value 3 and the current right child of 1, which is the null value. This result is a new node having the value 3, and that is exactly what we want. In addition to this, let's try to insert the value 5. The first call to the recursive method will do exactly the same thing it did when we tried to insert the first item. However, the result returned by the second call will differ this time, as the right child passed is not null and will not create a new node, but instead will call this method a third time, and this call will return the newly created node. Now, the third call exits with a new node which is set as the right child of 3, and we are back to the second call. We exit the if-else block, and the node passed is returned as is. Here this node is 3, and node 3 is reset or reassigned as the right child of 1. And finally, the initial call re-returns the root. And that's what we call a heavily recursive implementation. I hope you liked it, because the delete operation will be very similar to this one. In case of deletion, there is no need to return anything, but it is a matter of choice. You can return a boolean if you like. Inside the initial method, I am simply assigning the result of the recursive call to the root, similarly to what we did for the insert operation. Now, inserting a node involves returning a new instance of this node. However, deleting a node will involve returning the null value, and that is exactly what this if statement inside the recursive method is here for. The next thing we need to do is keep searching for the node we want to delete until we find it. So, if the data provided is bigger or smaller than the node we are currently standing at, then we have to keep searching inside the tree. Else, if it is equal, then we have to delete the node we found. To search for the node inside the tree, we are going to use a very similar approach to the one used in the insert node, as you can see in front of you. Now, inside the else block, we have to handle the three cases we covered at the beginning of the video. So, if the node to delete has a single child, then we have to return its child. And because of the heavily recursive way, this child will be automatically set as the child of the parent of the removed node. As you can see, if the node to remove has a left child equal to null, then its right child should be returned. And if the node to remove has a right child equal to null, then its left child should be returned. Notice that this if-else-if block also handles the leaf node case, since if the left child and right child are equal to null, then the first if block will return the right child, which is a null, and that is exactly what we need. The last case to cover is if the node to return has two children. In this scenario, as we previously discussed, we have to fetch the predecessor, or the successor of the node to remove, or in other terms, the maximum of its left subtree, or the minimum in its right subtree. Here I chose to retrieve the predecessor. What I did next is set the value of the node that I want to delete to be equal to this predecessor. Now we have two nodes having the same value, the value of the predecessor inside the tree. Therefore, what remains is to delete one of these nodes. To do that, we can go ahead and use the same deletion recursive call we've been using. However, the node provided to this call, the starting point or starting node of this call, should be the left child of the node to delete, which was the node we used to fetch the value of the predecessor. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.